An initial coin offering, or ICO, is a novel, unregulated means of raising funds for a blockchain startup. It's novel because this method did not exist before blockchain, and unregulated because blockchains lack the same strict governance that centralized institutions are often bound to. Companies developing a protocol often include a token within their platform. In order to distribute the token and also raise money for the company, they will sell some amount of these tokens as seed funding. These tokens often represent some unit of value within their network. However, it's possible that these tokens are associated with the company in name only. The concept of these tokens, regardless, is that their worth is tied to the value of the company. As the value of the company rises in value, then so will the demand, and, ideally, the value of the tokens. Hence, the value can be defined by the amount of faith the community has in the protocol's success. The greater the faith, the higher the value. This incentivizes the company to continue developing the protocol as well, so that the value of the token goes up. A few ICOs which have happened in the past 2 years span a great number of different projects, not limited to any particular industry. One example is Cosmos, a platform seeking to provide infrastructure for blockchain interoperability, raising $16,800,000 in USD through their ICO. Another is Filecoin, aiming to create a distributed file storage network, raising $257 million in USD. We'll see in a bit how much each industry has raised through ICOs. Let's take a deeper look at how ICOs innovate on previous fundraising mentalities. Previous kinds of fundraising, such as venture capitals, have often been through a select group of accredited investors. ICOs, however, allow for early adopters with a special interest and understanding in a particular blockchain use case to buy into the project early through the ICO, believing that it will come out on top. If the value of the ICO is tied to the value of the project, then those with high confidence in the project, due to background knowledge, will invest early. At least, that's the design. This allows for project teams to get past an initial high capital requirement to build out their protocol, while circumventing traditional centralized fundraising models. This allows developers to get a cash infusion, build out a protocol, raise the value of the token, and then give users the opportunity to use these tokens to request services. Ideally, this will align with the incentives of the development team and the early investors. Both want to see their token holdings increase in value, meaning the protocol needs to be developed as well. However, as we'll see, this is not the case today. We'll take a look at how ICOs might incentivize open source development. Open source development is typically led by foundations, such as the Mozilla Foundation and Apache Foundation. These foundations are dependent on donations and volunteers, as the work is not funded as a company is. Hence, there is a dichotomy between the value created and the profit. While many individuals develop open source software for the pure ability to benefit mankind, incentivizing open source software development could make it accessible to all around. The remaining majority is incentivized to make the software proprietary, causing technological lock-in. Companies hide trade secrets from each other to keep their leg up, slowing down intellectual growth. ICOs now allow creators of open source projects to directly monetize their efforts. Instead of looking for donations after pitching to philanthropic individuals their vision, individuals can now create a digital representation of the value of their platform. Additionally, as others build on top of that platform, the token will further increase in value. So what does the life cycle of an ICO look like? Well, let's start with the assumptions. First off, you're building a blockchain project, which requires some kind of token. In order to make the case clear for your project, you'll need to come up with a white paper to outline your project and how tokens come into play. Next, you'll need to decide on an ICO model. ICOs have sparked interest in the term tokenomics, referring to the economics of these digital tokens. Because of the nascency of the space, several models are still being explored and understood, all focused around manipulating a key few variables and qualities. For example, a question that arises is whether to have a fixed or dynamic supply of tokens. A fixed supply may limit the number of people who can buy into the ICO. But a dynamic supply will make investors uncertain about the total number of tokens to be sold. Next, there's the question about the number and types of stages to the ICO. Some projects have private fundraising rounds and pre-sales before the public sale. Additionally, there's the possibility of a dynamic price. A fixed price is straightforward. For some particular stage, sell at a set price. However, some ICOs aim to have dynamic pricing depending on the time and amount of tokens sold thus far. For example, Gnosis, a smart contract prediction market project, used what's known as a reverse Dutch auction. In this fixed supply and dynamic price model, the price starts off incredibly high at first, slowly decreasing, meant to encourage investors to buy at the highest price which seemed reasonable to them. However, the team underestimated the initial valuation of the tokens, Approximately $12 million worth of tokens sold out within the first few minutes, accounting for only 5% of the supply. This led to Gnosis owning approximately 95% of the total token supply, leaving everyone confused. This ICO, which happened in early 2017, demonstrated how much more there was to learn about tokenomics. Third, after deciding on the model, it's essential to determine the regulatory and compliance laws by which your model must abide and which are currently unsatisfied. One question that might be asked is which countries legally allow for your sale of token. Another is whether the type of token makes a difference on compliance. If seriously considering launching an ICO, hefty legal counsel is required to ensure that any and all regulatory concerns are handled. Fourth, your smart contracts need to be written. Every ICO is simply a smart contract, or few, which contain information about the ownership of every token, along with the functionality to send and receive tokens. The first step of development is to implement the functionality specified by your chosen ICO model, followed by inspecting the smart contract for security issues and vulnerabilities. Several smart contracts which hold money have been hacked in the last few years, such as the DAO, leading to a great push for more smart contract security checks. Finally, you'll publicize your upcoming project and ICO to potential investors to give everyone the opportunity to invest in your marvelous project. If that all works out, then you'll get funding for your revolutionary blockchain project. Legal uncertainty, as expected from so new a space, also permeates ICOs. Note that most of the legal precedents are still being established in both the US and around the world, and what we offer is in no way any legal, financial, or other advice. Instead, we attempt to show you the current state of the industry. Leaders in the space, such as Coinbase, have written up material to serve as guidelines for evaluating tokens. Often, we find that ICOs are classified into two kinds of tokens: security tokens and access tokens. Securities are financial investment vehicles, such as stocks in the company. Take the DAO, for example. The SEC ruled that all tokens distributed by the DAO are considered securities, since they satisfied the criteria for a security. Recently, companies have hesitated from selling to US citizens to avoid crackdowns by the SEC. On the other hand, access tokens are not meant to serve as any kind of financial investment. Instead, they simply serve as a way to access services, such as how Kickstarter donations provide the user with access to early or special goods from the team. Another caveat to consider is the reluctance or even inability of project teams to keep their promise after an ICO. After all, after raising $200 million, what's the incentive to do anything else? There's no VC or investor to demand money back. After all, the token does not provide such a privilege. Additionally, because most ICOs peak once and never recover to that original value, early short-term adopters end up benefiting at the detriment of long-term adopters. In 2017, investors in ICO presales tended to sell right away, gaining 4 to 5 times returns on their investment instead of waiting for the long term. One proposed solution was for funds to be held in escrow, released only when the team hits particular milestones, to incentivize them to build out the project. Hence, teams are less likely to abandon their promises. However, then the problem of deciding who determines when milestones are paid out arises as well. The solution is not popularly used in ICOs. Recall, the purpose of an ICO is to remove regulatory bodies from the picture. However, without regulation, regular users are at higher risk. For example, thousands of investors bought into OneCoin, a cryptocurrency in name alone. This currency was purely run on SQL servers, entirely centralized. Everyone bought into it, assuming there was a blockchain use case underneath the project. As most investors are unused to projects springing up into the public eye without prior due diligence, either by investment firms or by government bodies, they may fall prey to scams such as this. Additionally, ICOs ironically end up in centralization. As you may have noticed, founders and early investors end up disproportionately more wealthy than others, frequently the result of pump-and-dump schemes, implying larger investors artificially raising the price with the expectation of selling at a high value, leaving everyone else to bear the consequences. Finally, to demonstrate the success of scams in the ICO world, take the project known as Mirovsky, raising over $70 million in funding without even having a real team. In fact, unless Ryan Gosling is going under the pseudonym Kevin Bellinger and nightlighting as a graphic designer, his image was used without permission as one of the members of the team. Despite such a clear act of fraud, this project managed to obscenely fill their pockets. With the benefits of deregulation, such as larger freedom and accessibility to a larger set of investors, also come the consequences. The new paradigm of ICOs don't just have drawbacks for investors. Project teams also miss out on crucial benefits compared to VC funding. VC funding requires high levels of disciplines. Investors seek out 10x, 100x companies. You're not going to win their approval with just a lousy white paper. You'll need detailed financials to prove your merit and have answers to incredibly tricky questions about the fundamental assumptions of your company. VCs do due diligence on projects both for the consumer but also for the founders. If a VC agrees to invest in the company, then that person has access to the VC's vast set of connections and experience. This can change the development of a project team. ICOs, on the other hand, are nothing more than lumps of money. They do not come with the support that a VC can provide. This model of funding comes with many further drawbacks. As mentioned before, there is no central or trusted party to carry out due diligence on behalf of individual investors. Instead of VCs carrying out the groundwork and governmental regulatory bodies preventing clearly poor investment decisions from reaching investors, ICOs are accessible to all. This is a huge distinction between ICOs and IPOs. Though IPOs require years of scrutiny and thought for even the most well-established companies, ICOs occur solely after a project idea and still raise exorbitant amounts of money. The burden of due diligence is now upon the investor. But how many investors actually read the whole white paper? How many investors look into each and every member of the team? Because of this, lots of ICOs unashamedly use marketing strategies to make the impression of profits for investors, even without any significant technical knowledge to fulfill unrealistic expectations. Additionally, investors tend to be of a particular mindset. Most early adopters already have a reasonably similar mindset, leading to a lack of diversity in thought with the project founders, possibly stunting growth. Finally, there is a much larger number of investors to appeal to when launching an ICO, anywhere from hundreds to thousands, all of whom have different demands and expectations from the project. Because of this, managing relations with all these investors can overwhelm small teams, a large reason why companies prefer staying private to focus only on the few large investors. Though ICOs provide tremendous access to funding, you know what they say, be careful what you wish for. In 2017, we saw ICOs overtake VCs as the most popular form of funding for blockchain startups. By the end of 2017, about $6 billion was poured into blockchain startups through ICOs, over 25% of which was raised in December alone. Compare this to approximately just over 500,000 raised through VC. In 2018, we saw even more raised through ICOs, totaling $20 billion before the end of September. You may have noticed that this graph does not have the same generally increasing trend as the previous year. Instead, every third month seems to spike, followed by a couple months of relatively less funding. In fact, VC funding has recently surpassed $4 billion, up a great deal from 2017. Since ICOs seem not to provide long-term returns and have lost credit as a funding mechanism, VC funding is starting to surge. You'll see in this slice the distribution of funding. As expected, the largest slice of the pie is infrastructure, at 25%. A majority of this comes from EOS, a distributed proof-of-stake blockchain. Infrastructure has a habit of having the most funding, given that the space is still new. Finance is second largest, followed by communications, trading and investing, payments, and more.